issue was the was that that was of serious concern was like when I was like 4 months pregnant, 1 month. I used to, this is my baby. I used to take get up in the morning. I prepare her. I take her to school. I bring her back and all of that. Even in the process of trying to make her to become cultured, because she was so uncultured. She talks. She uses abusive languages and all of that. She doesn't hear that from us in the house and all of that. So I try to put things in order in her life. So one morning I was sick. I was not feeling fine. So I got up, the housemate prepared the baby and told me that the baby is ready, please come and carry the baby to school. I said, well, please, I'm very sick. Take taxi money and carry the baby to school. As she was taking the baby to school, she told the baby, we are going to school in a taxi. The baby said, there cannot be two cars. I mean, at the age of four, the baby will tell me that there cannot be two cars in my father's compound and I'm going to school in a taxi. Go and tell that woman to get up from that bed and come and take me to school. I mean, the thing got on my nerves. I was like, what is this? What kind of unruliness is this? So I said, that point of discipline, you are only going to go to school in that taxi. Your nanny will take you to school and bring you back to school so that tomorrow when there's no car in the house, you know that you have to take taxi. So my husband was seeing that and seeing it like I'm maltreating the child, I'm treating the child and sending the child away from him. So all of these things came into play and all of that. So he was kind of like, and with the new baby now, I am happy. I'm rejoicing. I look at my baby, I smile and all of that. And since the child is not comfortable her with me, with my presence, so she also keep her own distance. So the distance made my husband to become very uncomfortable. And 3 months ago, he told me that the baby, that my stepdaughter is not happy. That the baby is just, he's just seeing the baby a type in the house. That if I don't make things right in the house, if the baby is not comfortable with my presence, I should pack my things and leave. Yes, I should pack my things and leave because he's not going to sit down and watch and stay in a house where the wife is this way with her child, the stepdaughter is this way and all of that. He doesn't know how to manage the situation. So the best thing is for me to pack my things and go. So I said, okay, fine. So with the course of time now, he decided to bring me to the Synagogue Church of All Nations so that the man of God should handle our case because it is more than him. He doesn't know what
is. Okay, in the course of your experience, sharing your experience with us, you made us understand that you got to a state whereby you have to start taking this, your stepdaughter, from one place to another, one prayer house to another. Could you tell us the reason why you are moving her from one prayer house to another, and what was your impression right at that point in time?
Yeah, the thing that was surprising to me was that this baby doesn't like, even when you're reading your Bible in the house, she tells you, don't read that book yet. So I don't want you to read that book. Is that the only book you can read in this house? You take her to church, she doesn't want to go to church. Come on, let's pray. No.
You said you took her from one prayer house to another. Could you tell us what was your impression about this, your stepdaughter?
From what the men of God were saying, the impression was that the baby is possessed. So I don't hide anything from my husband. I came and told my husband that, please, this is what I've been told. This is what is happening. So what do you think? I don't hide anything from him. There are times that even when I point out something that is not right with the child, my husband gets so angry with me that he will not talk to me for 2 weeks.
Okay, finally, you are here in the Synagogue Church of Four Nations. What do you want now?
Well, what I want is that the man of God should say something about the baby and about our marriage, because I'm here for man of God to help me. Yes, because this man, he wants me out of his house.
Okay, let's hear from your husband.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. My name is Helms Ato. I'm a Cameroonian. I live in Namibia with my family. This is my wife, Jacoy. This is my daughter.
Okay.
This is my daughter from another relationship that didn't go well. And the mother, at the age of 10 months, when this child was 10 months, tried to commit suicide and abandoned the baby. And the government gave this baby to me, and later on, I had full custody of the child. I've been living with her since the age of 10 months. That's our son, Helms Jr., and my mother-in-law, Memeka Terai. As we were here on Sunday last week, I was one of the first people the Spirit of God located through the man of God, Prophet TV Joshua. I was seated right over there. He came to me. He said, how are you, sir? I said, I'm fine. He said, where is your wife? I said, there is my wife. He said, there's a problem in your home. For the past 3 months, you've been living like cats and mice at home. There's no peace in your home. Your wife loves you. This is a woman God has given you, but there's no affection from your side. And he asked me to try to help my wife. Those are the prophecies, and I confirm that prophecy to be true. As my wife said, 3 months ago, we had an argument, and I told her, if we cannot solve this problem in our home, I cannot live like this anymore. That was in August, and I told her very clear that there's August, September, October. By the end of October, if we cannot find a solution, I'm renting an apartment, she goes and stays with a little boy, and I stay with a girl in the house. So how did this come about? When my wife came from Cameroon, I'd already explained the situation of this little girl to her in Cameroon. So when she moved over, we got married, we are living happily. It was just honeymoon, seriously, it was just honeymoon. 6 months, 7 months, 8 months down the road, my wife is not getting pregnant. She starts getting very worried. Start getting worried, I'm not getting pregnant. She starts praying, fasting. 7 days, I've never seen it. 7 days, day and night, she will eat nothing, drink nothing. Just praying for the fruit of the womb. I told her God will give us a child at his own time. That didn't end there. My wife now started praying with a lot of pastors, too many pastors. And they started giving too many revelations. One of the revelations is, the reason she's not conceiving is because this child is possessed. Now, this is a child I've been living with at the age of 10 months. I don't know anything about that. I said, fine, tell the pastor to come to our house. As we see on the Mama TV, when somebody is possessed, they deliver the person. This pastor came, stayed with us, asked me to get salt, olive oil, and a breakable plate, that they'll do deliverance in the middle of the night. He came in the middle of the night, he did the deliverance. And to be honest, I thought that was it. The pastor left and went back the next day. Still, this problem continued. At that point now, you see the tension between my wife and the little girl, and it's creating a distance. It went about 3 or 4 months again. Still, prayer, fasting, prophecies, revelations, it's every day. One morning, my wife got up and said to me, her wedding ring, she cannot find her wedding ring. She went to bed with the wedding ring, but she cannot find it. It's been removed from her hand. I said, what do you mean? You might have forgot it on the bedrooms. Just check around. Prophecy came from that situation that the little child is possessed and is fighting the marriage. That's why we're in that situation. The little child wants her. Then now I said, okay, fine. Let's go to church. Let's go to your church. We went to our church. We met the pastors. They prayed. They delivered the child. We went back home. Situation is not changing. At that point, I'm confused. This girl, at that age, 3 getting to 4, or just about 4 there. Depression has kicked in. She's on depression medication. I was like, no, a child at that age cannot be on depression medication. Because the child is by herself. My wife is by herself. I come home. I'm confused. I don't know what to do. I love my wife. I love my daughter. I find myself in the middle. I don't know what to do. I just said to myself, she's praying every day. God will definitely answer her prayers, and she'll get pregnant. We live like that. No happiness. 3 or 4 months down the line, my wife told me she's pregnant, and I was celebrating. I said, this is the end of our problem. No, that was not the end of our problem. Now, she got pregnant. I thought the distance will close. The problem will get solved. The problem didn't get solved. At that point now, it got worse. My wife, I only heard this story she explained about her reason of not taking the child to school, why I was in scorn, and we've been living. And this has been going on for more than a year. So she stopped now taking the child to school. Like we said, we are blessed. We have a lot of cars. She drives. She's at home studying for a master's degree program in public health. So she studies. She stays at home, studies at home. She's not working. So she normally takes the child to school. They go to church together. Now she stops taking the child to school, stop taking the child to church. The nanny is the one taking. She gets up, gives the nanny taxi money to take the child. The school is 5 minutes drive from our home. 5 minutes. Sunday, she goes to church, the nanny takes the child to church. I look at the situation, I said, fine. She's a pregnant lady, let me just leave it. They say when a lady is pregnant, her attitudes, her behavior, everything changes. I left it at that point. But it went on and on. I got up one morning, I said to her, I don't understand what's happened. Where is that beautiful, loving, God-fearing lady I got married to? How can you be so bitter? How can you be so bitter even to take a child to school? I don't care what it, whether the child is possessed or not. This is a child God has given me. That is my cross. But if I'm alive and I'm seeing you, you cannot take this child just to school. If I'm dead, will you pay her school fees? That's what I ask her. No reaction came from my wife, and honestly, that moment I died, everything died within me. I just decided, fine, I'll just wait for her to give birth. I see how the situation will go. She gave birth. I'm hoping now she has given birth to a child. Maybe she will understand how I feel towards this child, now that she has a child of her own. That's my thinking. But still, it didn't get any better. It just didn't get any better. The distance is just there. My wife wants nothing to do with the child. We are living in a house. There's no happiness. There's no love. There's no togetherness. I'm confused. I don't know what to do. I said, at that moment, I just made a decision to myself. I said, my wife is studying. I cannot live with this situation anymore. It has already taken, it has given me so much stress. My BP has gone so high. I'm already on BP medication. I even left my house one morning so confused, so stressed, drove my car into the street. And an oncoming car had to hit me. Luckily, it was a small taxi. I was driving a Land Cruiser. It hit the car and everybody, it wasn't driving too fast. Nobody was hurt. I just apologized. My insurance took care of everything. And at that point, I started thinking, no, I cannot live like this anymore. I really don't know what I have to do. I made a promise to myself, I'll make sure my wife finishes her studies and fight, make sure she gets a good job. And I started talking to my friends in her field. You're in public health, my wife is studying public health. Please, I want her. So we've already started that process. In my mind, I'm thinking, when she gets a job, she settled, find an apartment, I put her with the child, we try to live apart, I see if that works. That was what I was thinking. And I'd made up my mind quietly within me. We are just living, no love, no happiness, no affection, nothing.
Even in the midst of this challenge of your biological daughter being alleged as a witch, and you are still, you know, trying to make preparation for your wife to get a job after her studies.
Because that's our son. If I'm not dead tomorrow, I want to know that my wife is in a situation where she can take care of the child of our son. That's what I was thinking to myself. Now, with that mindset, I just decided I'll leave this situation at that point. 3 months ago, as the man of God rightly said, my doctor is also a family friend. They have 3 daughters. Friends of hers. So when I went to my doctor that my medication is not working, my BP is still high, I'm having a lot of headaches, please do something about it. She changed my medication. Then she says to me, but it's weekend, why don't you send Emma over to spend time with the girls? I said, it's fine, I'll drop Emma over on Friday. Going to pick Emma now, they called me on the side. They said, what's going on in your home, Helms?
Who is Emma?
The doctor's husband.
Who is Emma?
Emma is my daughter. Emma is my daughter, this one. I drop her over at the doctor. It's a family. The husband is a medical doctor. The wife is a medical doctor. The husband is a Cameroonian as well, living in Namibia. We're in a Cameroon community. We socialize in that way. So I drop Emma over. Now going to get Emma, the husband called me and said, Helms, what's going on in your house? As a medical doctor, I will speak. I really don't want to get involved in your family issue. But this child is very depressed. This child is very depressed, and she's refusing to come back home because I've been trying to take her home. She's crying and refusing. She doesn't want to go back home, that she's not happy. Upon hearing this, I became very sad, seriously, and angry. I took Emma home. I called my wife. I told her, see, we have 2 kids. We cannot have this girl and the little boy in the same house as parents, and one is getting all the love and all the affection and all the attention, and the other is getting nothing. So this situation has already gotten me so stressed up, I cannot take it no more. This is August. August, September, October, 3 months. Within these 3 months, find a way to see how we can live in this house as a family. That's what I told my wife. If not, that's it. We are going apart. I find an apartment for you. What I was planning to do after, I decided I'll do it now. Because I just couldn't take it anymore.
And this is in accordance with the 3 months the man of God, Prophet T.B. Joshua,
that
mentioned.
Exactly. Seriously, our journey here, coming here, has been too long. It's been 2 years of pain, 2 years of frustration, 2 years of unhappiness. Still, it was a challenge coming to school. So now, when I said that to my wife, she, a couple of days later, she went to see her pastor now. Her pastor called me. I think she explained the situation, what I've told her, that we'll go apart. The pastor called me and said, your wife told me this problem you guys are having at home concerning this child. I said to him, but Pastor, I'm in your church. My wife fellowships here. You are telling me this problem. We've been bringing this problem here for over a year. If there's no solution, what really do you want me to do if not to just separate them apart? Because I cannot take it. You are a pastor, pray and deliver her. The pastor says to me, no, it's not that I cannot pray or deliver this child. It's that too many other pastors have spoken and my wife is dead convinced the child is possessed. So he doesn't want to say anything because it will be controversial. So he now says to me, the people, the coordinator in Namibia who coordinates for people to come to SCORN, it's coming to his church in the next 30 minutes. So that is the only place he believes I can go, and the only man he believes that can speak peace and happiness into my family is Prophet T.B. Joshua.
I mean, this was the recommendation given by the pastor in Namibia.
This is what the senior pastor of the church told me. He also came to SCORN. He was here last week. He said, I'm going to SCORN. Prophet T.B. Joshua is my holy father. He said, so I'm going to SCORN. The people organizing the trip are coming to my office. So if you can afford it, please, that is the only place I know that you can go and you have peace at home. Because once Prophet T.B. Joshua speaks, there will be no, he will deliver your family. So that is why I came here. And I came here, once I walked into church, I was giving my seat. I was just praying to myself, Lord, let the man locate us. We cannot come here and go back because this is our last bus stop. That was my prayer. I was one of the first people he located. So I'm here trusting that while we are here live speaking, this problem is finished. We go back, a happy family. I love my wife. I love my daughter, but I just don't know which side to go. I cannot take sides. I just cannot take sides. Cannot take sides. Even coming here, the day before we started our journey, a good family friend called me in the morning and said, where are you, Helms? I said, I'm on my way to work. He said, have you gone too far? I said, yes. I left early because I have a very long day because I'm traveling tomorrow out of the country. He said, please come. I need to see you. I have a message from you. The Holy Spirit, I was praying and the Holy Spirit gave me a message for you. I said, Holy Spirit. He said, fine, I'm coming, but I'll see if I cannot make it during the day. I only come at the end of the day on my way home. So I couldn't make it during the day. At the end of the day, around 9 p.m. on my way home, I stopped by her house. And she says to me, she was praying and the Holy Spirit gave her a revelation that we shouldn't come to SCORN, we shouldn't go to Nigeria, we'll find no solution there. We should rather go to South Africa and go to South Africa to this Malewan prayer.
Okay. Well, we all know God is able to do all things. In the midst of this confusion, you finally made your way to the Synagogue Church of Four Nations, the Arena of Liberty. Now, what do you want to hear from the man of God?
I second what my wife said. I want the man of God to speak on this child and to speak on our marriage. That's all I came here for, and that's what I'm praying for.
Thank you very much. Let's hear from our mother.
Emmanuel. My name is Madame Catherine Jacoy. I am a Cameroonian. This is my son-in-law. His name is Mr. Hemster. Then this is my daughter. Her name is Kukun Jacoy. Then this is her son. His name is Hemster Jr. Then this is her stepdaughter. Her name is Emma Atut Monica.
Okay, yeah, because of time, we know if we give you time to explain, we'll not be able to leave here today. And the man of God, Prophet Joshua, is eager to come to our midst. But before then, I hope you're happy that your daughter and your son-in-law are here to hear God's opinion about this marriage.
In fact, I am very happy because when I went to Namibia, I saw them living as strangers in the same house as
okay.
Cats and dogs.
Thank you very much. Thank you. To God be the glory. And we believe both of you have taken the right decision to come to the Synagogue Church of One Nation to hear God's opinion about this marriage and the oppression of this your daughter all over Namibia, to be precise. Of course, we believe God that the moment the man of God, Senior Prophet Joshua, comes into our midst, let's believe God that definitely we're going to hear God's opinion from him. God bless you, and thank you, Jesus, for this opportunity. Let's put our hands together beautifully for the miracle-working God.
Escuchamos la confirmación de esa profecía que fue dada la semana anterior por el profeta TV Joshua a esta familia. El hombre de Dios se acercó al esposo y le dijo que había problema en su casa, que no había paz en su casa y que estaban viviendo como perros y gatos. Y hoy esta familia está aquí para confirmar que lo que el hombre de Dios dijo es completamente cierto. Ellos nos cuentan que cuando se conocieron, él ya tenía una pequeña bebé, la que está en este momento aquí con ellos, y dice que cuando se casaron, la pequeña bebé vino a vivir con ellos, y desde ese momento, desde la edad que la bebé tenía 2 años, los problemas empezaron con ellos, además del hecho de que la esposa tomó mucho tiempo en quedar embarazada dentro del matrimonio, así que ellos nos cuentan que la situación empezó a complicarse, era una división entre la esposa y la hija, y dicen que la niña constantemente menospreciaba a la esposa, constantemente hablaba mal de la esposa o le hacía reclamaciones hasta el punto de pedirle que ella no la llevara más a la escuela, que no quería estar al lado de ella, que no quería estar cerca de ella. El esposo, en medio de esta situación, sin saber qué hacer, perdió el afecto por su esposa y además dice que la presión se le elevó a tal punto que casi tiene un accidente. No obstante, cuenta que al comentarle esta situación a su médico, ella le recomendó que enviara a su hija con ella y con su familia, pero la niña durante ese tiempo se convirtió en una persona muy depresiva, así que él decidió de nuevo traerla a casa y ellos nos cuentan que él decidió y habló con su esposa de que si la situación no mejoraba, ellos se tenían que separar, ella se tenía que ir a otro apartamento con el bebé y con el bebé de los dos y él se quedaría en casa con la niña, así que la situación fue muy complicada. La situación fue muy difícil, visitaron muchas iglesias, muchos pastores, hasta que hace poco, estando en su iglesia, su pastor le dijo que solamente había una persona que podía ayudar a restaurar su matrimonio y su relación familiar. Ellos nos cuentan que ese pastor le dijo que el único que podía ayudar en este asunto era el profeta TV Joshua, así que por eso decidieron venir la semana pasada aquí a la Sinagoga Iglesia de Todas las Naciones y para la gloria de Dios, Dios encontró su caso, les dio la profecía y ellos están aquí hoy para escuchar el consejo del hombre de Dios para la restauración de su familia y de su casa. Así que continuamos.
Vous avez entendu ce couple qui est venu présenter un problème très sérieux. La semaine dernière, l'homme de Dieu a donné une parole de prophétie. Il leur a dit qu'il voyait un problème dans ce mariage. Dans ce couple, depuis 3 mois, il y a un problème. Ils vivent comme chien et chat. Et aujourd'hui, le couple est là avec leurs enfants et la famille est là pour chercher la solution qui vient de Dieu. La femme a commencé à dire déjà qu'elle avait noté une attitude rebelle dans la vie de cet enfant qui ne voulait pas être corrigé. L'enfant vivait très mal, se comportait très mal et lui causait beaucoup de soucis. Et la femme dit qu'elle s'est mise dans la prière et dans le jeûne pour chercher une solution à l'attitude de cette fille. Comme elle n'y arrivait pas, elle était voir un pasteur. Des pasteurs ont prié et des prophètes ont prié et sont arrivés à la conclusion que l'enfant, la jeune fille, était possédée par un esprit. Alors, le père l'a très mal pris. Le père a dit que si l'enfant est possédé, alors qu'il la délivre. Donc le père s'est rendu compte qu'il y avait un très grand problème dans sa vie, dans sa famille, et sa fille, c'est la fille qu'il avait eue dans un autre mariage. Il ne pouvait pas abandonner sa fille. Donc il avait demandé à sa femme de trouver solution à ce problème. Et lorsque les choses ont continué à s'empirer, il a donné un ultimatum à sa femme que si dans 3 mois il n'arrivait pas à trouver de solution, ils allaient se séparer. Il dit dans le cours des choses, sa femme est finalement tombée enceinte. Et l'homme était très heureux de savoir qu'elle était enceinte, sachant que lorsqu'elle donnerait naissance, elle comprendrait ce que c'est que d'avoir un enfant et qu'elle comprendrait aussi la position du mari avec sa fille. Mais lorsqu'elle a donné naissance, il s'est rendu compte que les choses se sont empirées de mal en pis. Il n'y avait pas de solution jusqu'au jour où le mari a rencontré quelqu'un, un pasteur, qui lui a dit « La seule personne que je connais qui peut restaurer la paix dans ce mariage, c'est d'aller voir le prophète Ibn Yosha à la synagogue. C'est le seul qui peut amener la paix dans ce mariage. » Elle a dit de la résolution d'y aller. Le jour, la veille avant d'arriver, quelqu'un lui a dit, un pasteur lui a dit, « Oh, j'ai prié pour toi, le Saint-Esprit m'a donné une révélation. Avant de partir, je vais te voir. » Et l'a dissuadé de venir ici. Mais lui, par la foi en Dieu, il a décidé de venir ici avec sa femme et sa belle-mère, croyant qu'aujourd'hui, le Dieu vivant va apporter une solution au problème de ce couple. Que Dieu vous bénisse.
The footage you are about to watch is of a sensitive nature. It may not be suitable for all viewers, but it is for the glory of God. 58-year-old Mr. Omotosho Karim from Oyo State, Nigeria, has come to the Synagogue Church of All Nations with a deadly problem of throat cancer. This is the medical report from Lagos University Teaching Hospital showing the diagnosis of his ailment. Imagine how this problem has affected his daily life, not being able to eat or speak, and the terrible odor that would be coming out of his mouth. He has come to the Synagogue Church of All Nations with the belief that Jesus Christ can supernaturally heal him and bring life in abundance. The camera zooms into Omotosho Karim's mouth, showing a severe spreading of the throat cancer and swelling to the extent that it has closed the passage of his mouth. The pain is unbearable, and only a divine touch from Jesus Christ can reverse this problem. Mr. Omotosho Karim awaits at the prayer line in hope for Jesus Christ to divinely come to his aid and rescue him from the claws of sickness. Prophet T.B. Joshua ministers prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, and the power of healing falls upon him and breaks the yoke of throat cancer in his life.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the living Jesus.
Hallelujah.
My name is Karim Omotosho. I came to the Synagogue Church of All Nations to thank God for what God has done in my life. Because if not God of T.B. Joshua, I cannot be talking as I'm talking before you right now. I would have joined them in the graveyard. About some time, in December 2015, it started like a small bone hooked me on the throat. I started running from one place to the other. I go to many hospitals, including Lagos University Teaching Hospital. When I got there, they now diagnosed me and said, this is cancer of the throat and cancer of the mouth. Wow. What will I do? One day, I was with my doctor. He told me, he said, this growth is fast growing, and they have nothing to do than to cut my throat and pass a pipe, because they see that I cannot do anything with that mouth again. I came home, I said, wow, I have to run to the Synagogue Church of All Nations.
Okay, at this time, what were the things you could no longer do? Were you able to talk? How difficult was it that time?
I cannot eat anything, swallow. I cannot eat anything. I only take watery pap. That's all I can take.
And were you able to talk?
I cannot talk. I was even smelling. When I enter a bus, before you know, everybody in the bus will be saying, what is this? What is happening in the vehicle? What do you come in with something rotten? I know. Because when I enter a bus, I will go and sit by the side of the glass where I can put my mouth outside because of the smelling. Even many people rejected me because they know, me, myself, I know that I'm going to die because there's no more way. I vomit blood every day, serious blood. So before I run to the synagogue church of formation, I thank God of TB Joshua when I was arranged in the prayer line. Our Father in the Lord prayed for me. And instantly, the saliva that is uncontrollable stopped immediately.
Shall we put our hands together for Jesus Christ? So you mean before you came to the synagogue church of foundations and received prayer from the man of God, Prophet TB Joshua, the prayer line, you were constantly dropping saliva uncontrollably?
I was carrying towel in my hand. Because it's uncontrollable, I tried, I cannot do it. So it comes out like water every minute. So that is first thing that happened to me. The saliva stopped, and my body calmed down. I thought the meat, the other thing that is in my mouth will be coming out, but everything was just melting. I don't see it again. That's how everything went off from my life.
Hallelujah. We can see you talking now. So you mean you could not even express yourself? You
couldn't talk. Cannot. If I want to talk with anybody around me, I have to write it on the paper for them to know what I want to say. I cannot talk.
And all the pains you used to have then?
It's not a small pain. You what you watch, you will understand what I'm saying. The pain is so much, I cannot control it. But I thank God today that everything is over in my life.
You can see on the left side of the screen how terrible it was. It was spreading right from the mouth down to the throat, and he could no longer do things for himself. Eating was a problem. He could not talk. Pains and agony day and night. And he said when he was placed at the prayer line and the man of God, Senior Prophet TB Joshua, pray for him. As you can see on the left side of the screen, that is the same man. And after the prayer by the man of God, he was completely set free. So right now, can you open your mouth and let us see? Wow. Once again, put your hands together for Jesus Christ. Look at the left side of your screen. That was when his condition when he came to the Synagogue Church of All Nations. And right now, testifying on the right side of the screen, you can see all the cancerous growth, everything is gone, and now his mouth is normal, his throat is free. So now you can eat very well.
I can eat, I can do anything.
Oh, once again, let's put our hands together for Jesus Christ.
People all over the world, and my people that are here, in any situation you find yourself, please run to God. Because it's only God that's where you will find hope. I have lost hope. My family, they said, they want to take me to the village. They know that if they put me inside back to the village, it will be cheaper for them than dying here and take me to the village. So they want to take me there. They say I should come. If not, as I run to God, what will I be saying? So, please, in any situation, in any problem, just run to God, and you'll be saved. Thank you, Jesus.
To God be the glory. Watch your screen. And viewers out there, you can see the comparison between the shot on the left side of the screen and on the right side of the screen. This man testified that no one around him believed that he would survive. He himself had the thought, the belief in his heart that he was going to die. because he was no longer functioning like someone living in the land of the living. But glory be to God, he came to the right place and at the right time and met the right person, the anointed prophet of God, who waved his hand towards him, and the miracle happened. And now he's alive today to share that testimony. Put your hands together for Jesus.
Nous venons d'entendre le merveilleux témoignage de cet homme qui est venu à la synagogue de la nation avec un cancer de la gorge. Il a dit que tout a commencé quand il a senti comme un os entrer dans sa gorge. Et depuis cela, il a commencé à développer quelque chose au niveau de la gorge. Lorsqu'il a été voir le médecin a dit que là, c'était un cancer de la gorge, effectivement. Et c'est là que ça s'est commencé à se développer jusque dans sa bouche. Il ne pouvait plus manger, il ne pouvait plus parler, il ne pouvait même plus avaler sa propre salive. Et il commençait à saliver énormément, qu'il devait toujours se déplacer avec une serviette à cause de la salive abondante qui s'écoulait de sa bouche. Il a dit que même qu'il rentrait dans un bus, il était très inconfortable parce que l'odeur était tellement forte que les gens se plaignaient de quelque chose qui était pourri à l'intérieur du bus, que ça s'est toujours du côté de la vitre pour essayer que l'air puisse rentrer pour ne pas justement avoir cette forte odeur. Il dit vraiment les gens étaient désespérés, les gens pensaient que justement qu'il n'allait même pas survivre. Lui-même s'était déjà dit qu'il allait bientôt mourir parce qu'il ne pouvait plus vivre comme un être humain, jusqu'à ce qu'il vienne à la synagogue, église de toutes les nations, que l'homme de Dieu, prophète Joshua, prie pour lui. Il a dit qu'après cela, c'est comme ça que les morceaux de chair du cancer sont sortis de sa bouche. Il a dit qu'immédiatement, lorsqu'il a reçu la prière de l'homme de Dieu, la salive s'est complètement arrêtée immédiatement. Et aujourd'hui, il revient pour la gloire de Dieu, montrant qu'il n'a plus de cancer, qu'il peut maintenant parler, manger et vivre normalement comme un être humain.
Escuchamos este extraordinario testimonio de este hombre que viene a testificar de la bondad y misericordia de Dios. Él vino a la sinagoga iglesia de todas las naciones con un problema de cáncer en su garganta, que había obstaculizado toda su vida. Incluso para él comunicarse con los demás era muy difícil. Cada vez que él quería contarle algo a alguien, tenía que escribirlo en papel, debido a que ese cáncer que tenía en su garganta había afectado de tal manera que el olor era terrible e insoportable. Él nos cuenta que él no podía comer, que él no se podía comunicar y que él tenía una excesiva excreción de saliva en su boca y todo el tiempo tenía que estar escupiendo. La condición en la que estaba viviendo este hombre era terrible hasta que él vino y recibió oración por parte del profeta TB Joshua en la sinagoga iglesia de todas las naciones y ahora está aquí contando su testimonio y testificando la bondad de Dios y que ninguna partícula de cáncer ha quedado en su garganta, pues ahora es completamente sano, libre y está feliz con compartiendo su testimonio para la gloria de Dios. Continuamos.
My advice to the whole world is that when there is a problem, don't look at people. Just run to God, for Jesus Christ is the only hope. So please, run to God.
Jesus Christ is the only hope. Well, the Bible says that Jesus Christ is the answer to all fundamental issues of life. Be it sickness, be it setback, be it poverty, be it failure, barrenness, whatever it is, run to Jesus and you receive a solution. So we thank God Almighty for your life. And also want to encourage you that the healing you have received is for the salvation of your soul. And the only way you can maintain this healing is to make the word of God the standard for your life. And we pray that God Almighty will give you the inner grace to make God's word a standard for your life in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you. Once again, put your hands together for Jesus.
Get ready for a new beginning in preparation for the new year. The Synagogue Church of All Nations will hold a two-day revival of restoration titled Your Faith Will Not Fail. Friday the 9th of December, Healing and Deliverance Service. Saturday the 10th, Prophetic Service. And Sunday the 11th, Testimony Time. Registration for the healing services on Wednesday the 7th and Thursday the 8th of December from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. GMT plus 1. Bring your recent medical report. You will never forget who is the light when you come out of the darkness.
Tell your neighbor. neighbor. Hello, neighbor. Hello, neighbor. Golf time is the best time. Golf time is the best time. Put your hands together for him. Good time.
may be seated. Thank you. Hallelujah. Wow, I want to salute you. Viewers all over the world, I salute your faith. Wow, viewers all over the world. I'm not forgetting what you want me to talk about. I can never forget. I can never forget at all. Oh my God. Oh my God. You know, as your heart is in my heart, in the same way my heart seems, it's only you are not permit my heart in your heart. Because of your complaint now, you keep complaining. There's a lot of things going in your heart. Please, it will come and pray for me. Don't worry. God is in control. Well, last Sunday, how many of you came to service last Sunday? What a controversial service. Will I call it like that? Very, very controversial. That's to you, the prophecy by itself was not controversial. Rather, we human beings, the prophecy by itself was not controversial. Rather, we human beings. Tell your neighbor, the prophecy by itself was not controversial at all. Rather, we human beings. That's it. Oh, that's not controversial. What is controversial there? We have seen the outcome of the election of the United States. Haven't seen and heard, you will notice that prophecy was all about the popular vote. The vote of the majority of people, Americans. In this case, we need the spirit of a prophet to understand, to know, and to recognize what the prophet was talking about. You know, our level are different. You agree with that? I say our level are different. We are not on the same level. Take note of that. Our level are different, and we are not of the same level. That you have a very big cathedral, great cathedral, huge bear, all kinds of activities that are good by human standard. Remember, human point of view is limited. Let me take you to the book of 1 Corinthians, see what the Corinthians said there. First Corinthians chapter 1 verse 25. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human beings. And the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. That is, the foolishness of God, if there is wiser than that of man. The weakness of God, if there is stronger than that of man. There is no shortcut to spiritual maturity. There is no shortcut to spiritual maturity unless earthly understanding gives way to spiritual enlightenment. Unless earthly understanding gives way to spiritual enlightenment. Many people were trying to interpret prophets on the basis of their own mind and ideas. I quite understand the prophecy actually caused uproar to many who gave it different meaning and interpretation. Don't forget, politics, campaign and election in any democratic country are never about one person. It is about the nation, the country with care and love. It is about the country with care and love, never about a person, the campaign and election. If it is about the nation with care and love, whatever happens, we should accept the outcome and look to the future, Jesus, who is our future. The author and finisher of our faith. Don't forget, democracy is accommodation. If democracy is accommodation, all Democrats should value the process more than the products. Do you know what I mean by process? The process. Forget when I say look into future, the finisher and the author of our faith. That word is pregnant. And who owed the future? Jesus. Jesus owned our future. whatever happened, we should accept it and look to the future. Democracy is accommodation. It can accommodate anything. And you give you Democrats, they should value the process more than the product. So I want to say to the nation of the United States, God bless you. We rise up and pray for the nation. Whatever happened to that nation, it happened to the whole world. Rise up for prayer. Open your lips and ask God for the people of the United States and the world to accept the outcome and look to the future. Look to God, the finisher and author of our faith. Prayer. In Jesus Christ's name, we pray. To look to the future is to leave all to God. Leave it for God. Leave it for God. And let's move.